but let me just put this into perspective. ORF Mumbai is a non-partisan public policy think tank, and we work on several issues in Mumbai and outside Mumbai. And RTI is a integral part of good governance, and that is one of our very important mandates as an organization. When the new draft rules came in, my colleague Greek, who is a lawyer, background is law. Yes. So he had a special interest in, he's the one who came up with this idea of, kind of discussing this and saying that we should also have, we should put together something that we should send to the government and as a public policy think tank. So we thought we should get the best minds and together to discuss about the draft rules. So a little bit about what I think about this is, so we are co-moderating this panel. The RTI Information Act was one of the most progressive acts that came into being in October 2005. We know how much, it was a breath of fresh air that came in and the kind of transparency it brought in. And of course there were governments which fell and there were a lot of things, interesting things that happened, a lot of things came into the public sphere. On 31st March, the DOPT has now placed a circular which is about framing RTI rules 2017, which is in superposition of the RTI rules 2012. So, the current draft rules, there are 22 rules in this, which can be broadly divided into three categories. There are some which are replacing the existing ones, there are some which are in force since 2012, and then there are some which are completely new. Then there are some which are originally the part of the CIC Commission Management Rules 2007, which have been challenged in courts. So there are different, then it's a quite a mix of different things which are together in the 2017 draft rules. And in the current scheme of things, the states have their own individual rights to frame their rules and administer the act. But many of them do refer to the rules that come in from the union government. So, through this roundtable, what we are trying to do is looking at all the provisions in the 2017 rules, the old, new, trying to discuss them at length, having a fair deliberation about them. And ideally, we would like to see both sides of the coin and not only have and see what are the pros and cons of each of these draft rules. We are going to compile all the suggestions and objections and observations that come from all of you here and put it in the form of a report and ensure that it reaches the relevant authority. Before I hand over the mic to Greek, my colleague, who is going to explain to you how we'll go about this roundtable, I would really request everyone to stick to the time that is given to you. We have a board that will come down here which will flash the time. We also would request you to stick to the draft rules itself during the discussion and avoid making any allegations or political statements, because it will be left to our discretion whether to include them or not in the report. If it is, not related to the report. Of course, everything related to the report will go into the, report. Finally, I'd like to let you know that these proceedings are recorded. We have a YouTube channel, an ORF YouTube channel, where we will put up these proceedings for public consumption. So, yeah, I'd like to hand over the mic to
Deep
and explain to you
how. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I'll just quickly run you through the format. A copy of which is enclosed in your welcome page. Now, after Mr. Shailesh Gandhi, the chair, is done defining the roundtable, we'll have something called the around the world format, wherein, with the exception of Mr. Jain, who will get 10 minutes, each participant will go around the table. Each participant will get about 5 minutes to put forth general views and their views on the draft and what they think should be the pertinent topic of discussion as far as these draft rules are concerned. After which the moderators, that's Saini and I, will compile a list of things that we feel have come across as a consensus from the table, that these are the important areas that need to be discussed further. This will be followed by a freewheeling discussion where everybody on the table can participate, and this discussion will be led by the chair. And each of these, we want to make sure that each of these responses that you do in the second half, after your 5 minutes are over, each of the responses in the second half of the discussion must be strictly between 90 to 120 seconds to ensure that all the topics are covered in detail and that everybody gets a chance to speak. So yeah, what was the Shailesh can I do today?
Good morning, all of you. I'm very glad that ORF has taken this lead in arranging a round table for discussing the proposed RTI rules. I'm hoping that they will continue this and maybe hold discussions on the RTI Act, the way the whole law is going, interpretations of the law, and they showed some interest. I'm sure we will probably take this forward at some point in time. My views on the RTI rules are fairly well known, so therefore I'm not going to talk about it just now. Towards the end, if I feel there is something I can give an input on. But at the same time, I'd like to point out to Vip that while we talk of RTI rules, some comments and discussions on the RTI as it is are inevitable. But you are right, there should be considerable discussion on the proposed RTI rules. These are proposed, and let's see, a lot of us have given suggestions, but maybe this would be more weighty. And I'm very glad that Mr. Ajit Jain has decided to come. Such interaction of the Commission with citizens will be very welcome. So we start this. Mr. Jain, would you like to? We'll start with Mr. Jain. And all the others, we are giving 5 minutes. Mr. Jain, we are giving 10 minutes because he has got considerable experience as a bureaucrat and as the present information commissioner. And let me give you my assessment. I am usually very critical of commissioners and commissions, but I think Mr. Jain, I rate as amongst the good commissioners in this nation. Thank you.
WhatsApp ka zamana hai, to I think that's why. Coming to the point straight on, probably then we still have some time to submit our comments to the community regarding the talk. So the date has been extended perhaps.
So the date has gone.
Date has gone. Even now probably news can be given. Now very quickly, 2015 I think was the landmark year, and it was that year when RTI had completed 10 years, several studies and workshops were conducted to identify what are the strengths and maybe what are the weaknesses of the RTI regime. And one of the issues that was suggested was a better quality and fast disposal to the second party applications, because most of the commissions, of course, largely because of the cases, but the dependency was huge. Now, in Maharashtra, as you know, and I don't want to kind of digress for the subject, but we need to mention that so far we have received about 2.9 lakh second party applications of all benches put together since the inception, of which more than 2.5 lakhs have been disposed of. 37,000 are pending, and as you know, the 3 years is the record in the current period. You know, the experience that we have gained, based on that, I'd like to mention, that personally speaking, I am in complete agreement with the management. It's a debatable subject. I am in agreement with the new draft rules, which are suggested by the Government of India, by the UPT. Now, during 2015 generation, I think, Oscar and all, many of us were there in the Government of India's convention. I raised this issue that we should have comprehensive RTI rules, we should look at model RTI rules, and at that time, UP had initiated, Mr. Javed Swani, who is SCIC there, had initiated a very, very comprehensive draft of RTI rules, which covered not only second update, but all aspects. That draft has since been adopted by UP. I had reservations, on, because that was quite repetitive and too lengthy. So, we in Maharashtra, we started, I took that lead under the guidance of Mr. Gaikwad with Yashita, and we prepared a very comprehensive set of rules, and that is being debated. Now, as part of that, we looked at second appeal procedure also. And this is exactly what we had proposed, that the application many a time which are received by us are incomplete. For instance, if you are filing an appeal against the first appeal order, it is natural that you have to submit copy of the first appeal order. How can you entertain the appeal without the copy and enclosed of the order which you are challenging? That was one issue. In fact, another issue was that in many cases, a paraphrase is a slightly different subject. The first appeal order is in favor of the appellant, but since he did not get information, therefore he comes and challenges that kind of an appeal. But that I will leave, because then there is a Manipur judgment, you know, which created some kind of a dichotomy between section 18 and section 19. But to come back to the point, what the new rules propose, when if you could run through the draft rule, the new draft rule, I would say, largely focus on second appeal procedure. Pakiko is all, you know, with repetitive, as she said, and stuff. So I will focus myself only on that part of draft rules which deal with second appeal procedure. Now, if you go through the draft, rule 8, 9, 10, put together, will, to my mind, look at the screening, pre-hearing or pre-admission screening of the second RTI application, and they say that what all documents must be submitted along with the second appeal application. Now you will appreciate, the people with legal background, that RTI Act is not only a substantive act, in fact it is largely procedure, and that itself is the substance of law. Now, as I said just now, many people file second appeal because they have, though they have got a favorable first appeal order, but still they have not got information. So frankly, we have to kind of adjudicate on the facts largely. Therefore, unless the applicant submits his original RTA application along with the second appeal memo, right, the kind of reply that he has received or maybe not received from the PIO, the details thereof, the first appeal memo, and the order of this first appeal, you cannot adjudicate whether the information has been given or not given. So the appeals, like maybe in High Court, are different, or in the senior appellate courts are different. They largely decide on the issues of law. Here, we look at the facts and the procedural aspects more than the substantive. Because as far as the substantive part is concerned, frankly, it is for the High Court and Supreme Court to decide, you know, what constitutes RTA or what doesn't constitute RTA. So therefore, I am in support of this pre-submission screening, or pre-admission screening. So Rule 8, 9, and 10 look at that. The draft rule 11, it talks about the procedure that the commissions can follow, right? Now, currently what is happening is that we are, frankly speaking, we are screening the application, I am screening the application, but we are not rejecting it, by the way, if it is incomplete. We say, like, please make the compliance and you have a right to be submitted. So it's not that we are kind of scuttling the RTI, but we are saying you can resubmit the appeal along with these documents. Now, coming back to item 11, rule 11, it talks about the procedure. Look at the RTI. Section 18 is very, very elaborate about the procedure that one has to follow in case of hearing of complaint. It talks about your CPC procedure. You have the right, like a civil court, you can summon, you can issue, you know, even warrants later on, accept affidavits, etc. All for that. Now, this kind of facility on paper was not available under Section 19 procedure. As I mentioned just now, these appeals are more in the nature of fact finding. I mean, this is personally acting. That the information has been given, particularly as we are discussing what the date on which it was submitted, etc. So more fact finding. So you need to have documentary evidence in addition to the argument that is adduced at the time of hearing. And these new rules do facilitate that. That okay, you can even ask for affidavit. Honestly speaking, I have been now insisting on it in many cases, affidavit of the PIO, if he says that the information is not enough. And I say clearly, it has to be notarized affidavit. And things have improved a lot after that. Because if they give a wrong affidavit, then certainly it amounts to perjury. Rule 12, which is debatable, I think, and I think many people are advocating that it might be misused to terrorize the activists, is about a withdrawal. Personally, I have seen many cases in which both the sides come and fairly amicably say that I have got the information, therefore I am withdrawing. In many cases, as you all agree, most of our RTAs are related to personal grievances. That my pay fixation, I mean, my government servants are doing RTA, my pay fixation has not been done, my post-retirement benefits have not been given, And in the process, what happens is that not only RTI is replied, but their problems are also resolved. So they come back in many cases, happily saying to me, we have nothing more to add. However, if, to my mind, suppose if they write or they write under duress, that's quite possible. I mean, they cannot rule out that they are writing under duress. To my mind, I think they have always a right to say, to write back to the commission that this submission was given under duress, in which case we can definitely reopen the case. Frankly speaking, to my mind, one issue should have been done in the news, and that is about review of the decision. I mean, I will definitely confess here that while we are trying to clear the backlog of appeals, I have cleared about 13,000 appeals. There is a possibility of submitting some factual error or maybe an appreciation of facts. So we should also have a right to review our decisions. Perhaps we said that information has been given, it has not been given. Now what to do? Shall we say go to the High Court? To my mind, that's not that. Therefore, indeed, that should be. Now, as far as Rule 13, 14, and 15 are concerned, these are basically concerned, these are complementing the procedure regarding complaints, which has already been defined in Section 18. So, personally, to my mind, there is nothing wrong with the new rules, except Rule number 12 regarding withdrawal can be deleted. I would end up by saying that these draft rules are, to my mind, complete. We should look at the entire gamut of activity or procedure involved, types of submission of the RTI applications till that person gets the information. We should also look at proactive disclosure. We also look at how other acts, like public record acts, etc., or maybe right to services also now, could be integrated, if not possible through the act, but through the procedures. We have done that in our draft, but that is at the earlier stage. So since it is not in the public domain, I won't like to comment on that. But this is my personal view, that these rules need to be elaborated. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jaina. Just a suggestion, since you said the rules are being discussed in Maharashtra, I think in the spirit of RTI, these should also be opened up. And maybe enough time given for public reactions, discussions on this. The RTI actually, sir, is meant for the poorest man in this nation. And the law prescribes that a public information officer must help the applicant draft or write the RTI application. From that perspective, I think we need to pause for a while and say if that was the objective of Parliament, then, for example, if the Central Information Commission, I'm aware, about 40 to 45% of appeals and complaints are being sent back. So if a large number of citizens are being sent back, and most of them don't even come for a second appeal, really. It's not that everybody gets information. But anyway, we'll now take this forward. But Mr. Jain, your views are very valuable, and thank you very much. I think since you are a former bureaucrat, I would like to take you a little later. We had one bureaucrat coming.
Yeah, I'd also like to join later.
Yes, okay. Anil, tell me,
please. The RTI rule draft आया है, तो पिछले दिनों भी शैलेश जी के साथ कई सारे जगह पर इस पर डिस्कस हुआ है. Basically, जो RTI में जो 12 जो विद्रोह जो शिकायत को वापस लेने का, इसमें काफी कुछ चीजें काफी महत्वपूर्ण हैं, क्योंकि आज भी राइट टू इन्फॉर्मेशन ये जटिल सख्त तो अटपटा है, क्योंकि जिस तरह से राइट टू इन्फॉर्मेशन पाने के लिए चाहे सामान्य नागरिक हो या आर टी एक्टिविस्ट हो, ये सभी सर ने भी बताया, जैन साहब ने, कई सारे जो सरकारी अधिकारी और कर्मचारी बड़े पैमाने पर आर टी का इस्तेमाल इसलिए करते हैं कि उन्हें प्रमोशन के इश्यूज होते हैं, अलग अलग इश्यूज होते हैं. तो जो 12 जो उन्होंने किया है कि कंप्लेंट वापस लेने की जो अर्जी वापस लेने की जो प्रावधान, ये थोड़ा अटपटा भी है और थोड़ा डेंजरस भी है, क्योंकि जिस दिन ये आरटीआई का ड्राफ्ट आया उसी दिन पुणे में सुभाष हल्दनकर की मौत हो गई, उन्हें मारा गया, कत्ल किया गया. अरे कहीं ना कहीं तो जो अर्जी वापस लेने की जो एक प्रावधान किया गया है उससे जो राइट टू इन्फॉर्मेशन मूवमेंट कहीं ना कहीं तो इफेक्ट होने की चांसेस है. तो इस बारे में कई लोगों ने ड्राफ्ट रूल को चैलेंज किया है. और उसके अलावा जो सबसे मतलब एक तो उसकी निगेटिव पार्ट हुआ कि शिकायत को वापस लेना या शिकायतकर्ता ने लिख के दिया कि मेरी शिकायत को सुलझाया गया है, तो उस लेवल पर तो कई बार जो अलग अलग जगह पर जो चुनौतियाँ बनी हुई हैं, कई जगह जो जो कार्यकर्ता हो या आम नागरिक हो, जब भी कोई सूचना अधिकार का इस्तेमाल करता है, जैसे मुंबई शहर में इतनी दिक्कतें नहीं है, मगर जब मैं सोलापुर में गया था, नासिक में गया था, पुणे में, जो अलग अलग जो ग्रामीण इलाकों में, वहाँ पर काफ़ी चैलेंजेस थे। वहाँ पर सरपंच हो या पुलिस के जो सुपरिनटेंडेंट हो, वहाँ पर इतने आसानी से आरटीआई की जानकारी नहीं मिलती है। मुंबई में हम आसानी से आरटीआई जानकारी लेते हैं, पब्लिक डोमेन में उसे पब्लिश करते हैं, ये थोड़ी ईजी है, मगर जो ग्रामीण इलाकों में आज भी चुनौतियाँ बनी हुई हैं। मैं हाल ही में उत्तर प्रदेश में भी गया था, वहाँ पर भी वही स्थिति है। तो एग्जैक्टली जो अर्जी वापस लेने का जो उन्होंने प्रावधान किया है, जो उन्होंने सोचा है कि हम ऐसा कर सकते हैं, तो उसे अलग तरीके से लेने की आवश्यकता है। क्योंकि शिकायतकर्ता अगर की मौत होती है, उसके बाद अगर उसके एप्लीकेशन को डिस्पोज करते हों, वो भी डेंजरस है। क्योंकि जब भी मुंबई में कालीना में जो ओरा नामक एक कार्यकर्ता की हत्या हुई, तभी शैलेश जी के पहल पर मुंबई महानगर पालिका ने उसके सारी आरटीआई को पब्लिक डोमेन में लाया। अगर ये प्रावधान अगर ये इम्प्लीमेंट होता है, तो इस तरह की चीज़ों को रोका नहीं जा सकता है। तो कहीं ना कहीं तो ये प्रावधान को बदलने की आवश्यकता है। और दूसरी बात, क्योंकि मैं थोड़ा सकारात्मक भी बात करता हूँ, क्योंकि इसमें अमेंडमेंट में एक पॉजिटिव चीज़ ये भी है कि किसी शिकायत को कमीशन डायरेक्ट अपील में भी कन्वर्ट कर सकता है। ये अच्छी पहल है, क्योंकि इससे पहले इस तरह की कोई प्रावधान नहीं था। कई बार शिकायत करता, शिकायत करने के बाद कई सारे उसको कठिनाई आती थी, क्योंकि जैसे जैन साहब भी है, कई बार इनके ऑर्डर को भी निचले स्तर पर इम्प्लीमेंट नहीं किया जाता है। हर साल जो वार्षिक जो रिपोर्ट बनती है, वो सिफारिशों को भी राज्य सरकार और केंद्र सरकार इतने गंभीरता से नहीं लेती है, वो भी सारे कारण से। क्योंकि पिछले 11 सालों से जो राज्य सूचना आयोग की जो अगर हम सिफारिशों की बात करते हैं, तो कई सारे सिफारिश इतनी अच्छी है, अगर सरकार उसे इम्प्लीमेंट करती है तो एप्लीकेशन की संख्या भी कम होगी और जो बर्डन हो रहा है कमीशन पर, वो भी कम होगा। और दूसरी बात है कि इसके अलावा जो स्टाफ की जो एक कमी है, क्योंकि राज्य सूचना आयोग में बड़े पैमाने पर स्टाफ नहीं है, यही हालत नासिक में है, यही हालत अमरावती में है, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में भी वही स्थिति है। तो कहीं ना कहीं तो अमेंडमेंट तो ठीक है, मगर कुछ ऐसी चीज़ों को हमें सुझाव के स्टेट गवर्नमेंट में या सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में कि किस तरह से स्टाफ को बढ़ाया जाए। क्योंकि राज्य सूचना आयोग में जो सैंक्शन जो पोस्ट है, उसके तुलना में 70% पद आज तक भरे नहीं गए हैं, तो उन्हें भी काम करने में दिक्कतों का सामना करना पड़ता है। क्योंकि हम कार्यकर्ता हमेशा शिकायत करते हैं, मगर उनका भी जो पहलू है, उनकी जो समस्या है, उस पर भी ध्यान देने की आवश्यकता है। तो ये जो 12 प्रावधान को तो रद्द करना चाहिए, उसके अलावा हमें ओरप के माध्यम से जो अलग अलग राज्यों में जो स्टाफ की जो दिक्कतें हैं, जो सूचना आयोग को जो मटेरियल की आवश्यकता होती है, या कुछ चीज़ें वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंस के जरिए उन्हें अगर कुछ डीलिंग करनी है या अपील को सुनवाई करनी है, उसके लिए प्रावधान करने की आवश्यकता है। तो मेरा एक सुझाव है कि वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंस को राज्य में भी तवज्जो दिया जाए और जो ग्रामीण इलाकों में है, क्योंकि आज इस तरह की स्थिति हुई है कि जो शिकायत करता है, अगर कोई अपील करता है, तो 2 साल पहले गलत जीआर निकला सूचना आयोग की तरफ से कि जहाँ पर पब्लिक इन्फॉर्मेशन ऑफिसर और जो अपलिक ऑफिसर होगा, उसी पर ही सुनवाई होगी। लेकिन इसके पहले रूल ये था कि एप्लीकेंट जिस स्थान में रहता है, उसी स्थान के सूचना आयुक्त के बाद उसकी सुनवाई होनी चाहिए। मगर पिछले दिनों में जो एक सर्कुलर जारी किया गया है, उसके बारे में हमने स्टेट गवर्नमेंट को लिखा है, तो स्टाफ के अलावा जहाँ पर सूचना मांगने वाला कार्यकर्ता जिस शहर में रहता है या जिस जोन में रहता है, उसी सूचना आयुक्त के पास उसकी सुनवाई होनी चाहिए, ताकि ग्रामीण इलाके के लोगों को मुंबई शहर में आने की आवश्यकता नहीं है। तो मेरा ये 2 सुझाव है, इसे आप अपने माध्यम से थोड़ा उसे पटल पर रखने की अनुरोध में करता हूँ। धन्यवाद।
Is the purpose of RTI only to address grievances, or is it to make a more transparent, accountable democracy? If it is the latter, even if my grievance gets settled, if there is a flaw in the governance structure, that is what I believe should actually come up and surface. And of course, there is a lot of talk about some people who may use RTI, and once they get something. When I was Central Information Commissioner, I could see that there were people who would come to the office and say, I'm going to withdraw. And I, as a rule, used to order information to be provided, whatever it was, and I think further, because that is sensitive information, most of the times these withdrawals are sham. And even if I would say the grievance is addressed, the point is something wrong occurred, perhaps, I'm not necessarily saying it is wrong or right. It needs to come out in the open. We need to develop a complete culture of transparency, is what I would say. Next, Pastor, would you like to?
Yes, sir. and we settle information solutions. These are the only two information solutions which network with the citizen students. Otherwise, I have not seen any other state information commission networking continuously as a group. So, first we thank and show that there is a continuous dialogue with the commission. Please, we continue. Now, most of the things have been said in this by Mr. Anil Galgali, also Mr. Shailesh Nandi, and Mr. Chair. In this rules, draft rules, there are many things kept as an obligation to file submissions on the citizens, on the public information, or on the appellate authority. But there are no restrictions given for information collection, whether they should dispose of in the time limit. I think rule also should come out with a time limit for disposing of the orders within the time limit, at least the maximum of 90 days. And that rule must be there. And I think it is there in Jammu and Kashmir rules, if I am not wrong. One is that rule is mistaken, that there is a grave mistake. The second is that, okay, attaching of document, it's natural, the information commission should know about what is the status of the case. Right? We always tell in our campaigns that there should be a facts of the case and then the grounds of the appeal. That also you should mention in your second appeal. And also need to attach the documents that you have received so that the commission is fully known about the facts and the orders given are okay. But the restriction on an applicant to forward it to the PIO, to forward it to the appellate authority, the notice of what the submissions have been done to the commission, I think that is a little much more burden. The commission also can take it on their own to forward it to the public authorities, because the commission is having a net facility, and also the public authorities today are having all the net facilities. And other than that, all public authorities are intranet current. That means within a public authority, everybody is interacting. So to forward the application of the second appeal details to the PIOs and the appellate authorities should not be a constraint. Of course, the Anil Galgali has also said that there are some problem of staff. See, I think that we need not consider in the system how the administration, there is a sanctioned amount of staff and the government has to provide that. The third is that we consider information commissioners to be the ambassadors of the RTI. And you are ambassadors of the citizens. We don't consider information commissions to be ambassadors of the public. The commissions need to see when they receive applications for a second appeal. First, their job needs to be that whether it falls under the section 4 of the RTI. Otherwise, there was no necessary. Most of the applications that come, they come as, Baba, I have not received passport, work orders are ready. If you see, 99% of the work which comes is section 4 of the RTI. And when that comes to you, why an applicant has to do so much of efforts to come to the appeal commission? If I see here, most of the, because in 2000s, when Mr. Kulekar was information commissioner, that we had taken an issue of mass clearance. And they had told us to inspect, to bifurcate the application so that we can take issues under the mass clearance. So we nearly took around 6 years of the files and we bifurcated the application. We found 90% of the applications are under the, it falls under the section 4 of the RTI. So if it falls under the section 4 of the RTI, the information commissioners must pass a very strong order that this is the difficulties we facing by the. Now there are various other about the abatement of the RTI. Recently, if you see, there was one issue where Hardankar's recent issue, just because of the commission's order, everything is now published under the PCMC website. Otherwise, we would not have known about it. But first they did like an eye washing there. They just published the RTI application and the reply that was given. But when we further followed it, Mr. Gaikwad gave a further order stating that this is the time clocking of the order. So it should, now they have published all the matters over there. So I think that this, this clause needs to be removed. It is not getting the justice, it is getting the information. It is the right of a person to get the information. I feel that this needs to be removed. We have given around 27 pages of recommendations to the RTI, so we will forward it to the ORF and we can consider it. And as the time comes, we will.